good evening, everybody.
Hi.
How are you? I'm Joey G. We're going to take a journey back to the 1950s. How many people remember the 1950s? You're all older than I am, that's for sure. I'm only kidding. 1950s started off with big band. It went to pop and then to rock and roll. It went from listening to the radio to watching television. How many people remember their first television set, that 9-inch television set? Mine was a Philco. Yell out, what kind did you have?
RCA.
RCA.
Dumont.
What? Dumont. Dumont was big. Magnavox. That's another one. Well, mine was a Philco. But mine wasn't a 9-inch Philco. Not for my father, because my father heard a rumor that Philco was going to come out with a big screen television set. And he wasn't going to buy a television set until that big screen came out. So we waited, and we waited, and we waited. And guess what? We're the last one in the neighborhood to get a television. But a year later, Philco came out with that big screen television set. A 12-inch television set. My father was the first one to buy one. He went down to the store and bought it. Paid $150 for that television set. That's $1,500 today. He took it home and put it right smack dab in the middle of the parlor. We didn't have a great room. We didn't have a living room. We had a parlor, right? Remember the parlor? And there it sat right next to my mother's Italian professional furniture. You know the furniture with the plastic on it? You couldn't sit on it in the wintertime. It was too cold. And your ass stuck to it in the summertime. Remember that? And every night after supper. Now, we didn't have dinner. I don't know where the hell the word dinner came from. We had supper. And if you don't believe me, go home and check your Bibles. See if there's a last dinner in it. It's supper. Every night after supper, we went to the parlor to watch our favorite television show. And my mother's favorite television show was the Arthur Godfrey Show. How many people remember that Arthur Godfrey Show? So you ready to go to the Arthur Godfrey Show? How about a nice big hand for Arthur Godfrey? Come on. All right. Welcome to the Arthur Godfrey Show. Tonight we're brought to you by Camel Cigarettes. The smooth taste of camels. The cigarette that 9 out of 10 doctors recommend. That's a true commercial. So what do you say we go to the Arthur Godfrey Show? And our first guest tonight is Mr. Dean Martin. Thank you. My name is Dino Paul Crissetti. And I was born in Steubenville, Ohio. My mother and father only spoke Italian in the house. So when I grew up, I got in a fight almost every day when I went to school because I spoke broken English. Guys would make fun of me. I tell you what, I learned how to fight. By the time I'm 15 years old, I learned a very valuable lesson. I was smarter than all the teachers in school, so why should I stay in school? So I quit. And I started my boxing career a year later. And I like to say I won all but 11 of my 12 bouts. I won one fight. So I knew I couldn't be a fighter, so I took a job in an illegal casino stocking shelves. And I used to sing in the back room when the band was playing up front. And one day, the manager heard me. And he says, why don't you come up front, sing a little bit with the band. And there was an agent in the audience, and he liked me. And he signed me to a contract, and I started singing all these little clubs in Ohio. But one day, his best singer got sick. And he had to send me to Atlantic City to take his place. And when I get there, I meet this comedian from Newark, New Jersey. Anybody got an idea who that is?
Jerry Lewis.
And you know what? We had separate acts, but on the third night, Jerry came dressed up as a busboy. And we started our comedy act right there. And you know what? We lasted for many, many years. But when we split up, Jerry was doing okay. Me, not so good. But I got a little part in the movie with Frank Sinatra, and he took me under his wing, and he made me his best buddy. And I said, Frank, why me? Why do you make me your best buddy? And he says, you know why, Dino? Because everybody loves somebody sometimes. So you want to sing along with me? Okay, come on. Everybody, all together.
Everybody loves somebody sometimes. Everybody falls in love somehow. Something in your kiss just told me my sometime is now.
Come on, sing along.
Everybody finds somebody, somebody. There's no telling where love may appear. Something in my heart keeps saying, my someplace
all the ladies in the audience.
If I had you in my shower,
I'm only kidding.
I'd arrange every girl in the charm. And every minute, every hour, every boy would find what I found in your arms.
Your turn, sing it. See that? That's pretty good.
Mm-hmm. And although my dreams are overdue, your love may well run away for someone like you. If I had been my power, I'd arrange every girl. And every minute, every hour, every boy would find what I found in your arms.
Your turn, come on.
That's good. And although my dreams are overdue, your love made it well worth waiting for someone like you.
Dean Martin. You got a pizza parlor in this town? You know, you got a funeral parlor, you got an ice cream parlor. You got a pizza parlor. If you got a pizza parlor, you know the song. So, are you ready to sing along? Okay. Paisans, I got a new audience. What's my paisans? Okay. Ready, paisans? Here we go.
When the moon hits your eye, light up bigger pizza pie. That's some more.
When the world seems to shine.
The world seems to shine. Like you had too much wine. That's some more.
Your bells will ring.
Bells will ring. Ding-a-ling-a-ling, ding-a-ling-a, and you sing me the song. Hearts would sway, jibby-jibby-jibby-jibby-jibby-jibby, like a kick-tiling teller.
When the stars make you drool.
When the stars make you drool, just like Boston and Zoom. Got some more.
Not fair for an Irish guy, huh?
When you dance down the street with the cloud at your feet, you're in love. When you walk in a dream, but you know you're not dreaming, Signore.
Hey, all my paisans, here, come on.
Excuse me, but you see, back in old Napoli, that's amore.
Now it's your turn. Come on, when the moon.
Bells will ring, ting-a-ling-a-ling, ting-a-ling-a-ling, and you sing me the bell. Hearts will sway, tippy-tippy-tay, tippy-tippy-tay, like a guitar and a fella.
I love you, fella. Come on, when the stars make you drool.
When the stars make you drool, just like Barcelona's zoo, that's amore. When you dance down the street with a cloud at your feet, you're in love. When you walk in a dream, but you know you're not dreaming, Signor.
All together.
Excuse me, but you see, back in old Napoli, that's so. amore, amore, that's amore.
All right, give yourselves a nice big hand. Now, this next guy that's going to be on the Arthur Garfield Show used to be a barber before he was a singer. Does anybody got an idea who would it be? Terry Cohn. Let me tell you a little bit about myself. My name's Perino Ronald Cuomo. And I was born in I was born in Cannonsburg, Pennsylvania. One of 13 children. And the first one to be born here in the United States. Now, in those days, we had no welfare, we had no food stamps. So we all had to help out. So at 10 years old, I went down to the barbershop and asked if I can get a little job. And he says, yeah, you can clean out the barbershop. I'll pay you 50 cents a week. So I took that job and we helped my family. By the time I'm 12 years old, after practicing on my father and my brother's hair, they gave me my own barber's chair. I used to cut hair at 12 years old. At 15, my father had a very bad heart attack and he couldn't work in the mill anymore. So we all had to step it up. So I had a guy I was cutting hair for. He says, you know what? I got a little warehouse on the other side of Cannonsburg. Great for a barbershop. I got a spot over there. It'd be perfect for a barbershop. At 15 years old, I started my own barbershop. And he soon called me the singing barber. At 17 years old, I went to a picnic and met the love of my life, Rosalie. And we got married a few years later. Everything was going good. But one day, an orchestra came to Cannonsburg. They asked me to come up and do a couple songs. And they liked me. And they said, we want to sign you to a contract. And I says, I can't. I got the barbershop. They said, Rosalie said, you always wanted to sing, go ahead. So I went on the road for a number of years. But it wasn't working out. I missed my family, so I quit. And I came back to Cannonsburg. And just before I signed the lease for my new barbershop, I got a phone call from a guy. He says, listen, Perry, I just wrote a radio show. You'd be perfect for a radio show. I said, I can't. But Rosalie said again, you've got to do it, Perry. You want to sing. So I did. And I tell you what, the radio show was the biggest radio show ever. It was called the Chesterfield Hour. In fact, it was so big, they gave me my own television show and two cardigan sweaters to wear. Remember those cardigan sweaters? So here we are. I'm doing great. But just before our 65th anniversary, Rosalie suddenly passed away. And all I wanted to sing, I couldn't do it. I just couldn't go out there. I said, Perry, come out and do it one more time. I says, I can't. I just can't. Without Rosalie, it's impossible. It's impossible. Tell the sun to leave the sky. It's just impossible. It's impossible. Ask a baby not to cry. It's just impossible. Can I hold you closer to me, and I feel you going through me. Split the second that I never think of you. How impossible. Can the ocean keep from rushing to the shore? It's just impossible. If I had you, could I ever want for more? It's just impossible. And tomorrow, should you ask me for the world, somehow I can. I'd sell my very soul and not regret it. For to live without your love is just impossible. Can the ocean keep from rushing to the shore? It's just impossible. If I had you, could I ever want for more? It's just impossible.
possible. And tomorrow, should you ask me for the world, somehow I'll get it. I'd sell my very soul and not regret it. For to live without your love is just impossible. Impossible. Impossible.
Perry Como. Okay. Well, you know, we just moved, my wife and I, we moved to a 55 and older community in Wanacue Reserve. Anybody know where that is? Wanacue Reserve is just a little town. It's only got like one road going through it, the Ringwood Avenue. And my wife said, hey, we got a new place. Why don't we get a new doctor? So right on Ringwood Avenue, they got a doctor there. His name is Mario Bacigalupt. He was an Irish guy. And he has a very big practice because there's all seniors there. So, you know, I go into his room, and we're waiting, and we're sitting right next to this older couple. And we're right next to the examining room. And he calls in this guy. He calls in Harry first. He says, Harry, come on in. He says, how old are you, Harry? He says, I'm 95 years old. He said, 95? Your blood pressure's good. Everything's great. He says, you know, the government likes to ask a couple questions, you know, for Medicare and everything. He says, I got to ask you these questions, so hope you don't mind. Harry says, well, I do mind, but go ahead, ask the questions. So he says, your memory, Harry, how's the memory? I know the last time we talked, the memory's not there. He said, my memory's fine. Let me tell you something. I have no problem with my memory. So, okay. So, and the prostate, everybody, guys, you know what prostate is? Makes you go, you know, you're after 50, you got to go to the bathroom all the time. So he says, well, you know, how you doing with the prostate? He says, I'm doing fine. Don't even ask me. He says, you know, doctor, I only get up once a night. That's it. Just once a night to go to the bathroom. That's all I do. I says, I get to the bathroom, I open the door, good Lord turns the light on for me. I do what I have to do and I go back to bed. He says, okay, Harry. He says, you can go. Millie comes in. His wife says, how old are you, Millie? She says, I'm 92 years old. 92? Wow. He's 95, you're 92. You're both doing great. He says, I just checked your blood. Everything's good. He says, but you know, I got to ask you a couple questions. I don't want to ask Harry, but maybe you can tell me what's going on. I asked him, how's his memory? She says, well, his memory is like men's and men's, you know, half and half. It's not always good, but it's okay. And he says, he only goes to the bathroom once a night with his prostate. He only goes once a night, tell me. He says, he goes there, he opens the door, the good Lord turns the light on for him. He goes to the bathroom, he comes back to bed. Millie says, I wish you wouldn't say that. He says, what's wrong? Millie, what's the problem? He says, I just wish you wouldn't tell me that. He says, Millie, why is that a problem? That he goes to the bathroom, he opens the door, the good Lord turns the light on for him, he comes back to bed. She says, because Harry's peeing in the refrigerator again. Come on, dude. Okay. Now this next guy happened to change music forever. It wasn't Frank Sinatra. It wasn't Elvis. It wasn't the Beatles. It was this guy in 1951. He kind of changed things around where it kind of led into rock and roll. His name was Johnny Ray. Does anybody remember Johnny Ray? Johnny Ray changed music forever. And let me tell you a little bit about myself. My name's John Ray. I was born on a farm in Oregon. My mother and father were dirt farmers. They had no money. But my dream in life at 9 years old was to go to Boy Scout camp. I wanted to go to Boy Scout camp so bad. But we had no money. They needed me to work the farm. Never went until I was 13. When I'm 13 years old, they finally saved up enough money for me to go to Boy Scout camp. And when I get there, I'm the littlest, skinniest guy there. Now, when you're the littlest, skinniest guy at Boy Scout camp, you're going to be the guy in the blanket. And the big guys would throw you up in a blanket and catch you on the way down. One day they missed and landed on a pile of straw, and a piece of straw went in my right ear. And I developed an infection. In fact, I lost almost all of my hair in my right ear. I went home, I didn't tell my mother and father. And they saved up the money for me, and I said I didn't have the heart. So I lost all my hearing in my right ear. Remember I had that big hearing aid? In fact, it was the size of a small television set in those days. So here I am. We loved to go to church. That was our only entertainment. We went to church all the time, me and my mom and dad. And I joined the choir. But the choir was singing on one note, and I turned around. I'm on a completely different note because I can't hear the choir. I didn't even have a hearing aid at that time. So I'm going completely different. No, in fact, I start a whole new style of singing. So different that no one would give me a contract. They wouldn't even let me go into the studio. They wouldn't sign me to a contract. You know, I would lay on the ground. I would do crazy things because I just concentrated on the music so bad. But one guy believed in me. He said, Johnny, they owe me a favor over there at Columbia Records. Why don't you come over there? We got a country and western song. I got these four guys we just hired the other day. They call themselves the Four Lads. They'll back you up on the song. Well, guess what? That song went to number one. And it stayed there 11 straight weeks in a row. Nobody did it. Not Frank, not Elvis, nobody. Only me. 11 straight weeks in a row. Does anybody know the name of that song? It was called Cry. And I'm going to do it the way Johnny Ray did it. Is that okay with you?
Yeah.
All right. If your sweetheart sends a letter of goodbye, it's no secret you'll feel better if you cry. When waking from a bed, don't you sometimes think it's real? But it's only false emotions that you feel. If you know the words, if your heart aches, come on, sing along. If your heart aches seem to hang around too long, and your blues keep getting bluer with each song, remember sunshine can be found behind a cloudy sky. So let your head down and go right on, baby, and cry.
Here's how Johnny Ray would do it.
If your heartaches seem to hang around too long.
I gotta use this to get up. It's the Lipitor. How many people on Lipitor here? It affects your joints, it really messes you up.
With each song, well now, remember sunshine can be found behind a cloudy sky.
Help me out, come on.
So let your head down and go right on, baby, and cry.
Johnny Ray. Thank you. Now this next guy wore white buck shoes. Anybody got an idea who would that be? Pat Boone. Let me tell you a little bit about myself. My name's Eugene Boone. My mother called me Pat because everybody in an Irish family is called Pat. So here I am trying to get a record contract. I used to hang around the studio where I grew up in Nashville, Tennessee. And they would run the studio all the time. No one would give me a shot. But one day an agent came in from Columbia Records and he liked me. And he says, you know what? We're looking for someone complete opposite of Elvis Presley. Someone so different, so clean cut. You're the guy. So here I am. They signed me to a contract and I start singing songs like Tutti Frutti Over Rudy. And I'm singing songs, I'm selling records like crazy. Now one day, I was in a studio. In fact, I sold the second most records in the 50s. Other than Elvis, I sold the second most. One day I'm in a studio and they're recording a song right next to me. It's a slow song, it's monotonous, it's a poem. I said, give me a shot at that song, I really like it. They said, no, you stick to rock and roll. So I said, no, you owe me the favor, please, give me a shot. Well, I did that song, and it went to number one. It stayed there for a long time. It was my biggest selling song of all time. Does anybody know the name of that song? Take a guess.
On a day like today, we pass the time away, writing love letters in the sand. How you laugh when I cry each time. So the time, take our love letters from the sand. You made a vow that you would ever be true, but somehow that vow meant nothing to you. Now my broken heart aches with every wave that breaks over love in the sand.
Come on, can you whistle? Pat Boone actually did the whistling on the original song.
Now my broken heart aches with every wave that breaks over love.
Pat Boone. I'm doing that because this next guy is really hard to sing. He's really a tough guy. In fact, this guy would happen to be one of the greatest athletes to ever come out of the Northwest. He was All-State in basketball. He was All-American in track. In fact, he was so good in track that they gave him a full scholarship at San Francisco State University to become the high jumper. And he became the top high jumper in the country, if not the world. Now one day, this guy named Johnny Mathis went down to the mailbox, and there was two letters in there. The first letter, well, that was an invitation to the Olympics. That's how good Johnny Mathis was as a high jumper. The second letter, that was an invitation. In fact, it was a contract for Columbia Records to sing. And you know what? Johnny Mathis is no fool, because chances are he wouldn't have made the Olympic team.
Chances are, 'cause I wear a silly grin the moment you come into view. Chances are you think that I in love with you. Just because my composure sort of slips the moment that your lips meet mine. Chances are you think my heart, your valentine. When I sigh, only close to you. Chances are you believe the stars that fill the skies are in my eyes. Guess you feel you'll always be the one and only one for me. And if you think you could, well, chances are only good.
Eddie Mathis. Thank you. Okay. Now, this next guy really needs no introduction because he was born in Tupelo, Mississippi. Later on, moved to Nashville, Tennessee, where he took a job as a truck driver, and one day decided he was going to record a song for his mother's birthday. So he went down to this little record shop called Sun Records, and he recorded a song, and they liked him so much, they said, why don't you come back and do a couple more songs, and they signed him to a contract. Anyway, who do you think that guy was? Elvis. You know what, I could tell you a million stories about Elvis, so let me tell you the first time I ever sang an Elvis song. I was 13 years old, and I used to sing around the house all the time, and my mother used to say, hey, Junior, that's what you call me. Junior, you're a pretty good singer. But you know what, it didn't mean a lot to me, because my mother's Italian, and all Italian mothers tell the kids can sing, right? Everybody here knows that. So, you know, I waited and waited, and one day, my four Italian aunts, my mother's sisters, came over the house, and they sat in the parlor, right on the couch, and they listened to me. My mother says, hey, Junior, sing a song for your aunts. I says, Mom, they're 40 years old. They're too old. I don't want to sing for 40-year-old people. She says, yeah, sing. You know, you got to laugh a little bit here. Okay. So anyway, she says, sing for them. I says, Mom, I can't. I don't want to sing for them. She says, you're going to sing for them. I said, I'm not going to do it, Mom. She says, you want the wooden spoon? You know what Italian mothers do? I said, okay, Mom, I'll sing for them. So I sang a song called The Tennessee Waltz. People remember The Tennessee Waltz? Anyway, my four Italian aunts must have liked me, because if they like you, they come up and they pinch your cheek, right? So after the song was over, my four Italian aunts they got my cheek. And my aunt Mimi, she was ambidextrous. She got both cheeks at the same time. So I knew I could sing, even though my cheeks hurt for about a month and a half. Now I know I could sing. So I formed a group. I'm in the seventh grade. I formed a group called the Top Coats. And we entered ourselves in the seventh and eighth grade talent contest. Now, we didn't expect to win the contest. After all, there's going to be kids playing piano, someone playing a flute, someone's doing magic tricks. Who the hell knows? We're not going to win this thing. We didn't care. We didn't care if we won, because we only had one goal and one goal in mind. And that was to impress the eighth grade girls, because we're in the seventh grade, and they didn't want any part of us. They didn't want any part of us. They said we wouldn't dance with us, they wouldn't talk to us, and the guys beat us up every day. So you know what? We're going to get even. We're going to do a song, and we're going to get all the eighth grade girls to like us. So we practiced every day over my buddy Tommy Capek's house. He had a garage in the back, and every day we practiced a song called Just Walking in the Rain, a Johnny Ray song. One day his big brother, Frankie's like 16 years old. When you're 16, you know everything, right? I mean, there's no doubt about it. He knows everything. And Frank had his own band. He comes in and he says, you guys are pretty good. What happens if you win the contest? And I said, what are you talking about? He says, you gotta have an encore. And we said, what's an encore? We didn't know what an encore was. He says, you gotta have another song. You can't do the same song twice. I said, what do you think we're gonna do? He says, you wanna impress the eighth grade girls? I said, that's what we wanna do. He says, you do an Elvis song. You do an Elvis song, you'll impress the eighth grade girls. You know, we did this Elvis song called Love Me. And we practiced it, and guess what? We won the contest. So now we gotta come and do the second song. So I'm gonna do that song for you. Is that okay? Would you like me to do an Elvis song? Okay, so I'm gonna do it. I gotta ask you a favor though, if you don't mind. I hate to ask you this, but you'd do me a big favor, and I'd really appreciate if you would, especially the ladies in the audience, could I ask you this one little favor? Could you just be eighth grade girls for just this little bit? Would that be okay? And if I kind of go like this, would you mind giving me a scream here and there? Would that be okay? What do you say? Everybody? You with me? Not the guys, just the girls, okay? Thank you very much. Jerry, me like a fool. Treat me mean and cruel, but I'm alive. Somebody come and get my jacket, will you? Break my faithful heart, tear it all apart, but I love me. I'll see you after the show. If you ever go, darling, I'll be home. So lonely.
her heartbeat set in blue, crying over you, dear only.
Come on, eighth grade girls.
Just to feel your heart. Being lost in my
eyes. Come on, let's hear it. See you all after the show.
I'll be up. So begging on my knees, oh, let's just please love me.
Ed Sullivan, let me do this.
Against it. Just to feel,
yes, just to feel
your heart.
I want your heart
being close to mine,
so close to mine.
Darling, so.
That whole crew over there.
Begging on my knees. All I ask is please, please love me. Oh, yeah.
All right. Still 13 years old, and when you're 13 and it's summertime, you hang around. You ever hang around the ballpark with all your buddies, right? The 12 or 13 year old guys. And we used to hang around the park, up on the top of the bleachers. Always up on the top of the bleachers, talking about baseball, talking about girls. That's what you did when you're 13. Now, one day we're sitting there, and a bunch of 17, 16, 17 year old girls in the neighborhood. They came and sat on the bottom of the bleachers. And we couldn't help but stare, you know, because they had equipment our girls didn't have. You know what I'm talking about? So we're staring, they start staring back. When you're 13 and a 17-year-old girl staring at you, you gotta leave. So we go down to the bottom of the bleachers, and one of the girls called up and said, hey, Junior, remember they called me Junior. Junior, come in. I said, what, Ellen? Her name was Ellen Murphy, big Irish girl, 17 years old. She says, the girls think you're cute. I'm still pretty cute. What do you think? What do you think, ladies? Okay. So she says, we're going to the rock and roll show tomorrow. You want to go? I said, what are you kidding? Of course I want to go. She says, you know what? Well, we want you to come. And I says, I'd like to go, but you got to ask my mother. So they went across the street, and they asked my mother. I said, Aunt Jo, my mother's Josephine. I said, Aunt Jo, everybody in the neighborhood, by the way, is an aunt. I don't know about your neighborhood. All my neighborhoods, all my neighbors were aunts. And they came like with one uncle. Remember that? So she says, Aunt Jo, can we take Junior to the rock and roll show tomorrow at the Brooklyn Paramount? And my mother says, sure, take him. Get him out of my hair. Get him out of here. So we hop on a bus. We take the subway down to Brooklyn. There's 4,200 kids at the Brooklyn Paramount. That's what it held. And there's this big, enormous stage. I've never seen anything like it. And there's a big orchestra playing. Out comes this guy with a plaid jacket. He says, my name is Alan Freed. He says, and I got a great show. I'm the guy to name rock and roll. And I got a great show for you today. And he would have 20 acts. One would sing just one song, and they would hell out of there. That was it. Next act, 20 acts in a row. Now, one day when I was there, he had these two groups that really had the same song. They both had number one hits, but pretty much the same song. It just changed the words around. The background's pretty much the same. Wouldn't have made a copyright today, or wouldn't have passed. But in those days, didn't really matter. One group was from L.A. They called themselves the Penguins. And they had a song called Earth Angel. And the other group was from New York. And they called themselves Little Anthony and the Imperials. And they had a hit song called Tears on My Pillow. Anybody remember these songs? Okay. So you think I can get my voice to 13 years old again? What do you think? All right. So you got to help me along. Sing along with me. Little Anthony and the Imperials. Now it is. Here we go. Come on, give me an ooh. Come on.
You don't remember me, but I remember you. It was not so long ago. You broke my heart in two. Tears on my
gymnasium, right? And the boys are on one side of the gym, and the girls are on the other side of the gym. Remember that? And the DJ's going, how am I going to get these kids to dance? It's almost impossible. The boys are too shy. They're not going to dance with the girls. So he comes up with this bright idea. Why don't we have a ladies' choice? And as the girls cross the gym floor, he asks that cute boy they met in English class. The DJ plays the number one song of the 50s. It was a group from Bridgeport, Connecticut. They call themselves the Five Satins, and the song went like this. See if you remember it. Ready? It goes like this.
Show.
In the stage of the night.
Sneak over to his girl. He was so jealous of his girlfriend, he snuck over his house every night. Every night. One day he goes over to his girlfriend's house and he sees the shades and he looks in and she's kissing another guy. Anybody gonna know any of my song? I'm gonna do the first part, you're gonna do the second part. Ready? Okay? Here we go.
Silhouettes on
on the shade, said to my shop, you're on the wrong path. To your house with wings on my feet, love you like I never loved you, my sweet. Now that you and I would be two silhouettes on the shade all of our days, two silhouettes on the shade. Sing it. Was written in 1942, written by a young lady that was hoping her husband would come home from the war, say, Second World War. And she called it Hurry Home to Me. And although Dean Martin had it out, Peggy Lee had it out, everybody had it. I mean, just you name a guy who put it out, never made a big hit. Not until 1952, when a young lady named Joan Stafford changed the name to You Belong to Me. And then about 10 years later, a group from my hometown, Jersey City, the Duprees. So you ready to sing the song with me?
Oh, yeah.
You think you can do You Belong to Me? Would you yell that out when we do it? Okay, all right, here we go. Just remember, darling, all the while. Your turn. You can do better than that. See the marketplace in old Algiers. Send me photographs and souvenirs. Just remember when a dream appears. Come on, yell it out. There we go. I'll be so alone without you. Just remember till you're home again. Now, I'm going to count to three. In Jersey City, where I lived in Brooklyn, it's called Tree. Ready? So we're going to go. One, two, three.
You belong to me.
We got two more songs left. Is that? You having a good time? You can't do a doo-wop show without this group, because this group was the number one group of the 50s. They had 40 hits between 1952 and 1966. And four of them went to number one. Anybody gonna guess who that group was? Not close. It was the Platters. So, and you know what? They had four hit songs, four number one songs, and I'm going to do one of them for you tonight, right? It's called Twilight Time. Too far, she got the check, so better hurry up back with Liz. And I want to thank Howard for doing the video tonight. Give Howard a big hand. And my buddy Stu is in the audience somewhere, comes to all the shows, and Bob that did the singing for you, the bass guy tonight. Give him a nice hand. So I gotta tell you something. I don't know if it happens to you, but and I'm sure it does, because I'm going to prove that it does. When I get up in the morning, for the last 60-some-odd years, since I'm a teenager, so if you can add up 60 and 4, and then well, anyway, 74 years old. I can't figure it out myself. I don't want to figure it out. But I get up every morning, and I'm saying, the same people here, I know you're thinking the same thing. And I get up, I walk into the mirror, and I go, what the hell happened, man? No, I'm only kidding. I'm saying the same thing you're thinking. I bet you I'm right. You want to bet a little, you want to bet a buck that I'm right? Here's what I'm thinking, here's what you're thinking. Why must I be, see that? You're thinking the same thing I'm thinking. So when we get the teenager in love, you think you could do that part for me? Okay, here we go. Who did it? Do anybody know who did it? Deanna the Belmonts. Here we go. Each time we have a quarrel, it almost breaks my heart. For I
afraid that we would have to part. Each night I ask the stars up above.
Your turn, come on. That's good. Break out the clarinet.
One day I feel so happy, next day I feel so sad. I guess I'll learn to take the good with the bad. Each night I ask the stars up above.
Your turn.
I'll be lonely one if you should say we're through. Well, if you want to make me cry, that won't be so hard to do. And if you should say goodbye, I'll still go on loving you. Each night I ask the stars up above.
Come on, teenagers.
Nobody but you. I'll be lonely one if you should say we're through. Well, if you wanna make me cry, that won't be so hard to do. And if you should say goodbye, I'll still go on loving you. Each night I ask the stars up above.
Come on, one more time. Singing.
Why must I be a teenager in love? Why must I be?
Well, hope you had a good time. Again, we want to thank Liz for having me here tonight. Thank you, Liz. Stand up, Liz. He's not going to stand up. All you teenagers, thank you so much for coming tonight. All right. Now, if you belong to another organization like the library or JCC's, the Knights of Columbus, I know we're in Park Ridge, New Jersey, so if anybody in the family's getting out of jail early, come get one of my cards, okay? Thank you so much for coming.